right. Today, I'm just going to... the title is Heart for the House, but basically it's about serving. And before I start, I want to pray, because that's the right thing to do. We want to commit this time to the Lord. Just this morning, before we were coming to church, so in the car we usually pray, as in Arun comes earlier because he has practice and stuff. So me and the girls, we usually pray. And so Neha started this thing where, Neha is my eldest daughter, where she says the Lord's Prayer every time. So if you need a quick prayer, you just have to deal with it from start to end. So she prayed the whole Lord's Prayer and for the day, then fine. Then after that, I was like trying to squeeze another prayer. I said, I'm sharing today, you know, it's very scary, you know, and all that kind of thing. So the last time I said, I'm very scared, the last time I preached, she told me that Grandpa does it all the time. So today she said, okay, I'll pray for you. So she did a very good, proper prayer, like, Dear Lord, I pray that you give mommy wisdom as she talks about you and all that, fine. Then after that, Ria decides to pray. So she closes her eyes, when she prays, she like closes her eyes very, like she squashes it up. You know, like when some people pray for their food, they don't want it to run away, but they leave it a bit open. So she's praying there, and she says, Dear God, we pray for mommy. She's going on a Bible adventure in the church. In Jesus' name, amen. So she watches this live church, this live kids thing called Bible Adventure. And I was thinking, yeah, that's right, right? We are going on Bible adventures. So I pray that today we will have a nice Bible adventure. Amen. Let's close our eyes and let's pray. Father, Lord, we thank you for this day, oh God. God, you are faithful and you are good, oh God. And we are privileged, oh Lord, to be able to come together. We know that there's so much comfort, oh God, in this place and even in our country, no matter what happens, but we are privileged, oh God, to come together, oh God. And we pray, oh Lord, that today, Lord, as we speak your, as we learn about you more, and as I speak your word, I pray, oh God, for your presence, oh God, and your anointing, oh Lord, to fill this place, oh God. Pray, oh God, that you speak to our hearts, oh God, that you open the eyes of our understanding, oh Lord, that we will understand and see you for who you are, God. We will appreciate you for who you are, God. And God, we pray that your spirit, oh Lord, will just move in us, oh God. We want to be better, oh God, for you, oh Lord. We want to do better, oh God, for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay. So a heart for the house. Basically, the definition or what we're going to talk today is about serving. So a heart for the house is a heart to serve God, a heart for the people of God. Sometimes serving God is the easy part, right? If it's just us and God in the world, life would be great. I mean, no one says, oh, I don't want to serve God, right? If it's just us and God. But the people part is the part that makes it a bit complicating. Because if it's just us and God, we have a great time. And God teaches us and we just enjoy His presence. But when it begins with us working with people and dealing with people and stuff like that, that's when it becomes slightly trying in a way. But today we're just going to look at the word, see what God says about serving. And the purpose of this whole message is for us to be encouraged and to be passionate and to be driven to serve the Lord. Amen. So this is not like I'm not digging at anybody. I just realized that every time God gives me a message or a topic, it seems to be a dig at me. So Siapa makan cili dia rasa pedas lah. So I'll be feeling the pedas today, and I hope we all feel the pedas together. Alright, as I was preparing this message, a hymn came to my mind. I mean, I found it. I have no idea how to sing it, but the words are very nice. Does anyone know the hymn Only One Life? Oh, it's very old. It's like in the 1920s, but no one knows, huh? Okay. Alright, so now in 2020, I will read to y'all Only One Life. So I think it was written by this guy, C.L. Studd or something like that. But it says, so soon it will pass, only what's done for Christ will last. Only one chance to do His will, so give to Jesus all your days. It's the only life that pays. Right? So that's the gist of today. And the whole hymn, there's a whole lot of verses and stuff like that. But this is the gist of what God wants to speak to us. So a heart for the house. So as I was saying, right, it's easy to say, you know, every church or every person or every leader wants to tell people, oh, go and serve the Lord. And then after that, we're like, how do we serve? What do we serve? what is serving or and what is it. But today we want to look at what God calls serving. And it is difficult, but it's also not so difficult. Because the good thing about God is He doesn't just throw us into the deep. He throws us into the deep, and then He throws a net in, and then He gives us like a boat to come and save us, and then He gives us food. So we're not alone. He's given us every single tool, every single supply, everything that we need. All He wants us to do is to serve Him and the people around. Amen. So we're going to check our heart. So put your hands on your heart. Your heart should be on your left, maybe towards the middle, not anywhere else. All right. And we're going to say, Dear Lord, please check my heart. I'm not asking you to check my neighbor's heart, but my own heart. And I pray that you do something new in me that I may serve you more. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay. All right. So the first thing we're going to look at why. Why do we have to serve? Does anyone know why should we serve? Okay. All right. The why should we serve? It's like the rule of most things. We serve because God has commanded it. A lot of things God has commanded in the Bible. And in terms of serving, right? Serving, in Galatians 5 verse 13, it says, You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Okay, let's read in this version. You've been called to live in freedom, my brothers and sisters, but don't use your freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. Instead, use your freedom to serve one another in love. All right, so serving God involves serving others, serving the people around. Because when you come, when we say a heart for the house or what, we're not coming to worship the building. As we know that God is not defined by a building, He blesses us with a place to gather. But what is more important is the congregation or the coming together of His people, the community. So He has called us to serve and to do so humbly in love. And in Joshua 22 verse 5, it says, But be very careful to keep the commandment and the law that Moses, the servant of the Lord, gave you, to love the Lord your God, to walk in obedience to Him, keep His commands, hold fast to Him, and to serve Him with all of your heart and all of your soul. So this is something that God has said. So sometimes we have our lives, I mean, even me also, we have our whole lives, and then we fit God in our thoughts. We see it as something separate, you know. Okay, we have our lives, and then on Monday night, on Tuesday night, Thursday night, I'm free, so I will go and do some, go cell group, and go prayer meeting, and stuff. So I fit things in, then Sunday morning, and then that's our life. But if you look at the Bible, God says our whole life should be serving Him. So serving Him doesn't mean physically coming to church and doing something, but serving Him means we're always doing something for God. Whether it's at work, whether it's here, whether it's anywhere, He has commanded it. So if God commands it, it's a good thing and it's worth doing. Because later we'll look at why it's important to serve. We're looking at that now. All right, so whenever we say, I mean, if I ask you now, would you serve God? What would you say? Oh, okay, thanks for the three people, a few people. Come on, church. If I ask you, would you serve God? Okay, the what becomes the what do we do lah. So the idea is very noble and always answering and words are easy. But the action is the part. That is the part where we have to figure out today. And so, as I talked about just now, it's easy. And then when we actually have to deal with the people around us and with the human part of it, whether others or us, that's when it becomes a bit tricky, but we're going to figure it out. So the second part is, the reason why it's important for us to serve God is because God has created us uniquely. So we know, right, in Romans 12 verses 4 to 5, it says now, Romans 12 verses 4 to 5, okay, just as our bodies have many parts, and each part has a special function, so it is with Christ's body, we are many parts of one body, and we all belong to each other. So God has created each one of us unique, and we know God has created us in His image, but each one of us is special in some way. So you may say like, oh, I will never be able to sweep the floor like the other person. But it's okay. Maybe God has given you the skill to mop the floor, and that is your calling, and that's okay. All right? Or maybe you might say, you know what? I don't know how to arrange the chairs. But maybe God has called you to make coffee, and that is your calling. So that's just in a funny, in other ways, like, I mean, the common things is like, God, you see the people on stage, oh, I cannot sing like them, how can I serve God? Oh, I cannot play the guitar, how can I serve God? But basically serving is us being willing and asking and saying, God, I'm here and I'm ready to serve. And then I guarantee you, if your heart is ready and you want to serve, God will make a way for you to serve. Because it could be anything. Because He has created us to serve. And we are uniquely formed. I mean, we have this verse about how every one of us are different parts of the body. And this is our church body, right? This is us. So each of us brings something different, something unique. You might do the same job, but each one of us does something different. So that's why we serve. And it is important to serve because we have been uniquely created. All right, so okay, for example, maybe we talk about food, then maybe we will understand better. So say we have a pot bless. See, Ananda's nodding. He's like, praise the Lord, finally we're talking about food. Okay, so we say, okay, we have a pot bless, all right? And then usually in a pot bless, you will, okay, you, what are you bringing? You, what are you bringing? You, what are you bringing? And then maybe there's a mistake and three people bring chicken curry. Who likes chicken curry? I love chicken curry. Okay, so anyway, three people cook chicken curry. But honestly, I've never tasted a chicken curry that's the same. Nothing is bad or nothing is like not nice. It's just different. So that's an example of us. We've all been created uniquely. You might be doing the same job. You might be cooking chicken curry, but you cook it different. It doesn't make one bad or one good. It's just different. And that's how God has created us, unique. So remember chicken curry. All right? So the thing is, if we give this excuse, right, like some people say, oh, I'm waiting for God to open an opportunity. Sometimes we say that, you know what, God, I'm ready, I'm willing. I'm waiting for you to open an opportunity for me. But go and find the opportunity. There is so much to be done. There's so much things that we can serve in. And the thing is, so that's one thing. I remember Pastor Jerry Horner. I don't know if you all remember him. He spoke a few years back. He's this grandfatherly gentleman, sweet guy. But I remember I always have this question about what is God's will for my life. You know, we're always asking, what's God's will? You know, if I turn right in this road, is it God's will? Maybe I'm supposed to turn left, you know, with my car. Maybe I'm supposed to do this. And we're always having this big thing of what's God's will. And that Sunday, he had a very clear, simple explanation of God's will. He said, God's will is doing whatever you're doing faithfully with a pure heart. And then when he wants to move you to the next part, he will show you. So that was like a big relief for me, because that means I don't have to stress. I just keep doing faithfully what I'm doing. And when it's time for me to move to the next part of his will, if I'm faithful, he will just move. But if we stop now, and I'm going to talk about us not serving or not using our gifts, our unique gifts. If we stop now and say, you know what, God, I'm waiting for you to tell me where I should serve. And then we don't do anything. So if we're not doing anything, then how does God, if we're not being faithful in whatever it is we are doing now, if we're not doing anything, how does God show us the next step? Or how does God move us? So in us serving, right, in whatever way, it also allows us, or allows God to show his will in our life. We have to be doing something for God to keep us moving to the next step. So that's the second part. God has created us uniquely. So use your unique gifts for him. All right? And remember chicken curry. All right. And another thing that we need to know is, while we are unique, this is the part that is not so great, like if you do it the opposite way, we are replaceable. God doesn't need us, you know, to serve. He's asking us to serve because for our benefit. I mean, we know God is God. He created the heavens and the earth. One snap, he can arrange all these chairs. So if we come to a point where we are saying, oh, we're so great. I mean, we'll talk about a selfless heart later. God doesn't need us. He's doing this, or he's telling us, serve. for our benefit. He wants us to see. He wants to see us blessed. He wants to see us prosper. He wants to see us live a fulfilling life. So just remember that while we are unique, we are also replaceable, which is there's the happy ending and the sad ending. All right, the third part is the reason why, or a byproduct of us serving, is because God wants us to be blessed. I said just now, God does not need us to serve, and He does it because He wants us to be blessed. So in Luke 6 verse 38, it says, "Give and it will be given back to you in full." Luke 6 verse 38. We'll read from NLT. All right. "Give and you will receive. Your gift will return to you in full, pressed down, shaken together to make room for more, running over, poured into your lap. The amount you will give will determine the amount you get back." So it's very interesting. When I said give, what did you think of? Anybody? Someone's doing that. This is like our famous offering scripture. Give money, give money, give. But God never mentions money. One pastor said, he was Robert Morris, I think. Anyway, he was interviewed. And you know what? There was this whole like giving, prosperity thing going around. So the interviewer asked him, "So pastor, how often do you speak about giving?" He's like, "Every Sunday." And then the interviewer said, "Oh wow, you're really speaking a lot about giving." He said, "Wait, are you asking me how often do I speak about giving? Or how often do I speak about giving money?" He said, "Giving money, I speak once in 4 years. But giving every Sunday." He said, "We cannot speak about the grace of God if we don't speak about giving." I mean, you know John 3:16, right? For God so loved the world that He gave. Not money. He gave His Son. That whosoever believed in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. So don't limit the word give to money. It is so much more. So giving, or in this case, giving, serving, it involves so much more. It involves our time. It involves our resources. It involves of our knowledge. It involves so many things. And when God says, you see, every promise, right, when we say about giving, God has the next part is to bless us, to give back. He wants to give back. He wants us to learn how to bless, to serve, to give, because He wants to bless us. So the same amount that you give will determine the amount that you give back. And He gives back. And also, not always money. Sometimes we're like, "Oh, God hasn't given me anything this year because you didn't get any money." But He may have given you health. He may have given you good sleep. And health is expensive, you know. Have you gone to the hospitals lately? So He's given you good sleep. He's given you health. He's given you peace. There are many people who have no peace at night. He's given you strength to take care of, I don't know, children or even your older parents, or even to do your job. He's given you wisdom, knowledge. There are so many things that He blesses in. So let us ask God to open our minds, and even as we give, to open our minds to be able to understand and to acknowledge the things that He gives back, and to appreciate it. Because sometimes if we're only appreciating when we give money, we get money, We've limited it to like very little. So God gives, and he as we give, God gives back. All right. So it was interesting. Luke 6:38. We've always heard this scripture: "Right, give, and it will be given to you." And you know what? Okay, give people. But on an interesting note, in Luke 6:37, okay, before you change it, Sarah, who knows what's Luke 6:37? It's the famous, so famous scripture. Judge. You know the judgy scripture? Judge not. Okay, can turn it. Do not judge others. So before Jesus spoke about giving, He also spoke about judging. All right, so I'm going to put this on the, park this on the side, and we're going to talk about this later. But basically, Jesus started this whole passage about giving with judging, and how we should not judge and all that. Then He moved on to giving. All right. So the things that God has given us, right? All these things that we said, knowledge and life and even legacies. A lot of us are here because other people have given and served. It might not be our own parents or our grandparents. It might be other people, uncles, aunties, communities who have given. So giving and serving is what has God has called, but giving and serving is what God has called us to do so that we can be blessed. Does anybody not want to be blessed? Okay, good. Because I know you all don't like to put up your hands, so I just changed the question the other way. I mean, God wants to bless us. So God wants to bless us, so be happy about it. All right. Okay, are you all good so far? All right, so 3 points. The first one was, God, we serve because God has commanded it. And all everything has Bible references. Okay, it's not my Rhenita school of theory. It's from God. The second thing is we serve because God has created us unique. Okay, we remember the scripture about the body and how each of us bring some are created uniquely. And remember chicken curry. The third thing is we serve because God wants to bless us. And I don't know about you, but I really don't mind being blessed. It's quite a nice thing. All right. Okay, so now we're going to check our hearts. I have 4 things, and then we'll be done. So just 3. 3 points, why God wants us to serve, and 4 points for us to help us serve. Okay? It's His, H-I-S-S, like a snake. His. All right? So remember, 4 points, H-I-S-S. So the first check for our hearts is as we serve, and when we serve, we have to do it with a happy heart. Ah. So for those of us who are serving and those of us who are going to serve, this is the first check. When we do it, we have to do it with a happy heart. So I'm going to define what is happy. I mean, happy is, I know you always say joyful. Joy is the one you choose to be joyful, and happy is the one that just happens. But in this case, to make it His, I made it happy lah. But basically, it's also from the Bible. Psalms 100 verse 2, the Bible says, serve the Lord with gladness. And it's interesting because in NKJV, it says, serve the Lord in gladness. But in NLT, it says, what is the first word? Right. So serving is worship. And we know that we've been called to worship God, right? God created us to worship Him. So worship is serving. And serving is worship. So even as we serve God, we're actually worshiping Him, you know, and acknowledging who He is and who and how great He is. So I thought that was very interesting that serving is equals to worship. So it says, serve the Lord with gladness. So that's what we are supposed to do. For all of those weary souls who have been serving in day in and day out, when the stress of the serving gets onto us, or the frustration of the serving gets onto us, we have to remember that we have to serve with gladness. I'm not saying that, oh, everything will be like on high on endorphins and like, oh, it's so great to serve the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. You know, like you can't be frustrated, or you can't, because it's normal to be frustrated. And I think to a certain level, it's okay. Frustration means that you are passionate and you're desiring more. But never let our disappointment or our frustration prevent us from serving the Lord with everything that we have. Whatever is the frustration or the disappointment, I mean, we deal with it. And sometimes it gets better and sometimes it doesn't. But the thing is, whatever we're doing, we do unto the Lord. We serve the Lord with gladness, because that's what He called. And our serving is not unto men. It is unto the Lord. So everything we do is unto the Lord. So when we make that connection that whatever we're doing is for the Lord, whether I teach Sunday school is for the Lord, whether I clean the toilet is for the Lord, whether I, anything that we do is for the Lord. So then when we make that connection, then we realize that we do need people around, but it becomes easier for us to move on in our serving. Because whenever we get held back by the circumstances or the frustration, or if it brings us down, right, then we lose out. And we lose out on God's goodness, because God is saying, serve me. But if you're like, oh, you know, this person did that, oh, I cannot serve anymore, like, you cannot serve here, I cannot do this. Then we are the ones who are losing out on the blessing, because God said, serve Him. All right? So serve the Lord with gladness. Turn to the person, because you're very quiet, turn to the person beside you and say, serve the Lord with gladness. and turn to the other person and say, worship the Lord with gladness. Amen. Because serving is worship. All right. So I want us to check our hearts. As I said, don't check your wife's heart or your husband's heart or your neighbor's heart or the annoying person's heart. Check your own heart. Because God wants us to just worry about ourselves. All right? So check your heart and make sure that we are serving with gladness. All right. So the second thing is, so what's the first thing? His happy heart. I serve with an intentional heart. Okay, a lot of things in life, we know, don't come easy. Exercise, it's not easy. To some it is, but I think everyone started at a point where it wasn't, and then it had to be something intentional. So I struggle with exercising. I can do better. But a lot of things we know, like, you know, in whenever you have motivational talks and say, oh, you do it 21 times, and then after it will become a habit. So whatever, 21 times, 50 times, 3 times, whatever works for us, serving has to become a habit. All right? So it becomes easier if we associate that we do it unto the Lord. All right? But we have to do it intentionally. It's not something that we just absorb into ourselves and one day we wake up and we're, oh, today I want to serve the Lord. I mean, God has given us all the tools, but everything is, we are flesh, you know, our flesh is weak. So we have to be intentional about it. All right, so same thing, always remember things like exercise or what we're watching, what we eat or anything of that. Everything is intentional. Habits that we want to form. Someone wanted to stop eating salt, so they didn't eat salt for 2 months and then it was okay. So, I mean, whatever, you want to eat salt or don't eat salt, that's fine. But anything that we do has to be intentional. And serving is also something that we need to build. We need to intentionally do. We need to choose to do. Because if we don't choose to do, and we have to choose to do it daily, in whatever way, and then it becomes part of our life. And the cool part or the great part is when something that is part of our life becomes a legacy and it just carries on. That's why I said we are all here because of the legacy of people before us. Whoever it is, whether you accepted the Lord in this, I mean, we all accepted the Lord in this life, but whether you were born into a Christian family or you came to know the Lord or whatever it is, we are here because of a legacy of people who have served the Lord and have passed it on. So it is our responsibility to pass on this legacy down to the next generation. And so we have to start doing it. So remember, we have to do it with an intentional heart. We want everyone to be servers. I remember when we went to, I think some of us went for this GLS conference in Seremban. And the church was very inspiring because they have a pastor of pastor of hospitality, but he says he has no team. He says because he can ask anyone in the church. I was like, whoa, so that's cool, huh? He has no hospitality ministry. He's just in charge of hospitality, but basically the whole congregation is in his ministry. So that would be great. That's what we want this church to be. Then Auntie Tina doesn't have to say, who can serve? To just walk up, okay, you, okay, Ken, all right, set. Amen? We want to be like that. We don't want to be the, I don't know, I'm not free today. I have this thing, maybe on the second Sunday of the third week of next year, I'll be able to. It's too far away. Because, you see, God has called us. Our whole life is for Him. Our whole life is to serve Him. Everything else supports that. God is the head, right? I mean, we know God is the head of the church. But God is the head of our lives. He created us to worship Him. And we now know worship is serving. All right, so that is the paramount thing. Our jobs, everything around us is not bad, but supports that we are serving and worshiping Him daily. So everything is to support that. So I want us to remember that. I'm not saying blindly like, okay, now I don't need to work anymore. Every day, anything can. Honestly, if you really do something crazy like that, I don't think God would fault you. You'll be like very happy. But I'm just saying that let's open our hearts to let God intentionally to serve God even more, to do more for God. Anything more than what we're doing today. So intentional, number two. 1 Timothy 4 verse 8, it says, on the other hand, discipline yourself. Okay. I like NLT. They are very down to earth. Physical training is good, but training for godliness is much better. Promising benefits in this life and in the life to come. We're not storing up benefits here. I mean, God will bless us here, but we want to store up for the benefits in heaven. Amen? So that's the second one. So first one was H, which was serve with a happy heart. And then second one is I, serve with a intentional heart. The next S, any guesses? S. I should have brought some Kit Kat. I can just throw. Woo! S. What? Selfless heart. Ah. So this is also another one. Actually, the fourth is my favorite. It's not English, but never mind. All right. So the third, serve with a selfless heart. When we serve, we do it with no... What does selfless mean? To do something with no personal gain. All right. That's very difficult, you know? I think that's something I struggle with. I think we, see, we all struggle with it with different levels, lah. But as I said, this is a self-check for our own heart. So when we serve, we do it with a selfless heart. That means anything that you do, zero personal gain. If zero people see you doing it, it's okay. If zero people know that you did it, it's okay. Because we do it without expecting any human appreciation, any human acknowledgement. But the thing is, whatever we do, God sees, right? And if you want to suck up to God, no problem. You want to do it for God, oh God, that's fine. I think He's okay with that. But remember that we do, when we serve with a selfless heart. So serve the Lord with a selfless heart. When we do something, it is unto the Lord. So in Philippians 2 verse 14, it says, do all things without grumbling or arguing. And in NLT, it says complaining or arguing. And in Matthew 6, verses 1 to 4, we'll look at verse 3, I think. Matthew 6, verses 3. The whole left-hand, right-hand thing. But when you give to someone in need, don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. All right. So, I've come from a generations of people who serve, and I'm so grateful for that. And I've also married a family who serves as well. But this thing, right, about having zero, that means we want zero, no, it's not zero regrets. We don't want any, we want zero acknowledgement, right? We don't want any, no personal gain, zero personal gain. Okay? It's something that we all have to check for ourselves. Some of us, if whatever we do is somehow not noticed, I mean, after a while, we are human, right? It gets a bit annoying and stuff like that. But we have to make sure that we are okay. Because when we come to a point where we are okay to serve and not have anyone care, but still we serve because we do it unto the Lord, then we've come to the right place. That's what God wants. He wants selfless hearts. He only wants us to please Him. Okay, when we start doing things to please man, or we say, oh yeah, you know, last week I came and I cleaned the church toilets twice, you know, so dirty. What's the point for the... I mean, that's just passing on that knowledge is like unnecessary. So remember, whatever we do it unto the Lord. Don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. So check our own hearts. Be honest with yourself. And we in the Bible, we have so many stories about the Pharisees. And when we read the Bible, we're like looking at the Pharisees and going, terrible people lah. And all that. But I was just having cell last week. Also, everyone please go to cell. Luke 15. I think each cell might be slightly different depending on where you are. But my cell was doing Luke 15 last week. And the whole, you know, the three parables. The parable of the coin and the sheep and the son. Right? But the first part, why Jesus actually started talking about everything was because the Pharisees were complaining. Right? And they were complaining, oh, you just Jesus, why he does this, why he go and sit with the sinners, and why he does all these kind of things. And sometimes we are like that. Sometimes we like have a lot of things to talk about. What, like even like why those people are doing that? Oh, sorry, that's actually the next point. But anyway, fine. So remember to serve with a selfless heart. Let's go to Matthew 6 and do the whole 1 to 4. Okay. Watch out. Don't do your good deeds publicly to be admired by others. So Jesus was talking to the Pharisees and to everyone as well. For you will lose the reward from your Father in heaven. It's quite intense, you know. It's not just like a recommendation. It's a warning, exactly. And if God warns us about anything, we should take note. When you give to someone in need, don't do as the hypocrites do, blowing trumpets in the synagogues and streets to call attention to their acts of charity. Tell you the truth, they have received all the reward they will ever get. I do not want to receive the reward that the hypocrites get. Next verse. But when you give to someone in need, don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. And in verse 4, it says, give your gifts in private, and your Father who sees everything will reward you. That's what we want. We want God to receive. We want God to reward, because that's the true reward. When we struggle for our own reward, when we struggle for our own acknowledgement, it falls flat. It doesn't work out. Okay, God wants us to serve Him. God wants us to worship Him. So as we do it with a selfless heart, we get His reward. All right, so that's the second point. So first point was serve with a happy heart. Serve with an intentional heart. Serve with a selfless heart. The last S. Any guesses? I'll give you a Ferrero Rocher. I think I have some left over from the last week. Serve with a heart that is not sibuk. So what's sibuk? You're so sibuk lah. Busybody. Not a busy heart. Serve with a heart that's not... Don't be a busybody. God didn't tell you to worry about how your neighbor is serving or how your person is serving. Oh, you're definitely serving like that. Huh? Too much. Huh? Definitely not serving. You see how much I'm doing? You know, these are all things. It sounds funny now, but it's very real. We're always comparing, like, oh, I'm serving the Lord so much, you know. Every time I ask that fellow, he can't say, don't care. He's answerable. He or she's answerable to God. You are answerable to God. If you are serving so much and you are being a busybody and thinking about what, you start reducing your reward with God, because God looks in our heart. He sees what we're doing. So he says, oh, wow, Rhenita, she serves so much, but nicely, talking about everybody who's not serving. So then we make our own serving become invalid. And that's not what we want. We want to serve with a true heart. We want to be selfless. We want to do it intentionally. We want to do it with gladness. We want to do it fully for the Lord. So don't be a busybody. Tell yourself, close your eyes, hold your hand over your heart and say, don't be a busybody. Say your own name. Don't be a busybody, Rhenita. All right? So don't care about others. I know our nature is very, we have this holy gossip, you know. Say, oh, you know what? Oh, you must pray for so-and-so, you know, to serve more. They're not really serving, you know, really pray. The last time this happened, that happened, oh, yeah, I wish they could be serving more. This is all holy gossip that does not benefit anyone. So just worry about yourself. In a way, I'm not asking you to be selfish. We encourage people to serve. We motivate and we say, do it as unto the Lord. But don't be a busybody. And that's where we come to the earlier Matthew 6 verse 37. So we remember in Matthew 6 38, we say, give and it will be given to you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, will be running over, pouring into your lap. And the amount that you give will determine the amount you get. But God, Jesus spoke in 37 about judging. So I found it very interesting that before he said about giving, he said about judging. He must know us very well. He said, do not judge others, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn others, or it will all come back against you. Forgive others, and you will be forgiven. Isn't that beautiful? Right? Then he goes on to talk about give, 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 give. So it looks like there's something that we have to work in our hearts first about judging. It's a big deal. So remember, don't be sibuk, all right? For those who do not know Malay, sibuk is actually busy. But we always say, you're such a sibuk lah. So busybody, don't be a busybody. All right, so remember, do not judge others. God judges. And the thing is, if we judge others, as I said, it nullifies the blessing that God wants to bless you with. You might be doing all the first things. I'm serving with gladness, intentional, and selfless. Actually, everything is connected. If one is not happening, the others also will find it difficult. It's like a package, you know. All right, so as we serve, and as we don't judge, right, then we don't get judged by God. I don't know about you, but I definitely don't want to be judged by God, because if you look, I mean, even in cell in Luke 5, this week, there was a part where God takes seriously people who are not leading their sheep properly and all that in Ezekiel. I tell you, if God judges us, it's no joke, you know. We'll have to run and hide somewhere. So, easier, don't judge others, all right? And we will not be judged. Do not condemn others, and it will not come against you. Whatever you do to others, the same thing. Whatever you do to others, I mean, God will hold it. It will come back to us, right? So if you do good to others, God will bless. If you want to start judging and condemning and not forgiving others, then do you want God to do the same to us? I don't want to. So it's better to just not judge. So the fourth thing is, don't be stable. Okay, all right. So as you see, in Matthew 14, verses 3 to 9, an example of stableness was with the disciples. The disciples were with Christ, and as we read the Bible now, it's like such a great thing that they were with Christ and all that. But even though they were with Christ, they were sometimes not so great. But before you judge the disciples, which is what I sometimes do, like, huh, you're with Christ, or so you want to act like that. Put yourself in their place, so they might not have had any revelation. But we look at Mark 14, verses 3 to 9. Similar story. All right. So meanwhile, Jesus was in Bethany at the home of Simon, a man who had previously had leprosy, while he was eating. It's quite sad that the guy had already been healed of leprosy, but he was known as Simon the leper still. And a woman came in with a beautiful alabaster jar of expensive perfume made from the essence of nard. So nard is this root that comes from the Himalayan mountains and is so precious. And the Bible says that it was worth a year's wages. So now put all your year's wages. Don't tell me or anyone beside you. It's all very private. Don't share your salaries. But this lady, this perfume or this jar, of this alabaster jar, was a year's worth of wages. She comes and she just breaks it on Jesus' feet. In three, right? So she broke open the jar over his head and poured the perfume over his head. And then we have the sabots in verse 4. Some of those at the table were indignant. Why waste such expensive perfume, they asked. But wait, we have holy sabots. Next page. It could have been sold for a year's wages and the money given to the poor. How noble is that, huh? They didn't want to keep it for themselves. They wanted to give it to the poor. They wanted to serve God. Anyway, so Jesus replied. And Jesus is the best replier. Like, you ask him a question and the Pharisees will be so upset. Let me tell you a story. And then they'll be like, what's happening? But actually, he's nicely like cow scolding them in the story. But Jesus replied, leave her alone. Why criticize her for doing such a good thing to me? You will always have the poor among you, and you can help them whenever you want to, but you will not always have me. So it's between this lady and her worship to Jesus. She wanted to use her year's wages and pour it out on her Lord who had saved her. It was ironic that this whole passage happened during the time of Passover. So we know what Passover is, right? In the time of the Israelites. I mean, we don't celebrate Passover, but basically it was the last strike. God was going to send the last plague, and he was going to send the angel of death to kill all the firstborn children. And he said to his people, I will paint your doorposts, and I will pass over. And they avoided the judgment of God. So this lady is worshipping the lamb who was going to be sacrificed for her. In other versions, right, it says that this lady was immoral woman, or we are not sure about her state, lah. But basically, we are all sinners. But the thing is, she had recognized who Christ was, and she was worshipping him. And it was her money. She didn't go to the disciples and say, I'm collecting offering to buy my nard, and then we will break it on his head. She minded her own business. I have my year's wages. I want to bring it before God. I want to pour it on his head and worship him, anoint him, because in 2 days he was going to go to be crucified. And the disciples were doing that. But the thing is, we are very much like the disciples, whether we want to admit it or not. We're like, oh, such a waste. When people give like a certain amount of money or their time, oh, such a waste, huh? could have been used for better use. I mean, we sit and have this holy gossip things around us, but it's none of our business. What a person does for the Lord, whatever is in their heart, God knows. And Jesus acknowledged it. She, whatever she's doing is a beautiful thing. And she's worshipping me. So basically, just stay out of that. So everything that we do is unto the Lord. It is none of anybody else's business. So if we are serving the Lord with everything that we have, if we are serving the Lord with gladness, intentionally, and with selflessness, and not caring about, not being a busybody, minding other people's business, God sees our heart, and He knows that's true serving, and He is pleased with it. And He's not going to start ridiculing, oh, you're going to give me so much time. God doesn't do that. He wants us to serve Him. He acknowledges it and He praises it and He blesses us and He gives us the tools that we need to serve Him. I mean, what greater opportunity or what greater thing is there than serving Him? There's like so many pros. There are no cons. You know, everything is like, oh, weigh the pros and cons. But with God, there are no cons. He said, worship me, serve me. Worship equals serving. Serve me. And these are all the things I will give you, the blessings, you know, everything, I will just give it back to you. So this morning, I just really want us to be aware of that, because it's so worth serving Him. It's so worth giving everything that we have to Him, to be a house that serves Him. And when I say house, I mean the people in this house, right? I said a house is not a building, it's the people in it that God wants. Be all of us. And when we as a church, right, serve Him, right, with all these things, when we serve Him with gladness, when we serve Him intentionally, when we serve Him selflessly, when we serve Him without caring, without being busybodies, then He knows that our service is our serving is for Him. And then He gives you the reward. And you see how God gives us reward. He doesn't say, oh, you give me $1, I give you $1. Even $2, I give you $2. Oh, you give me 2 hours of your time, I give you 2 hours. No, God gives extra. I mean, you see in Luke 6:38, give and it will be given to you. Press down, good measure, shaken together, running over, poured into your lap, poured into your bosom. Oh, overflowing. That's how God gives. So his calculations, right, are higher in percentage. It's not like a ratio of 1:1. How much more? That's up to Him. Don't start, hey God, you said you were poor over. How come I give you $1, you only give me $2? You should give me $5. You know, don't have all these selfish conversations with God. Just know that He knows best. So I want to encourage us, church, this morning. Whatever we've been doing, I'm not saying some are not serving, some are serving. It's none of my business, because I mustn't be a busybody. It is our own business to look at our own hearts. So look at your own heart now, and I just want to share some verses on serving. Hebrews 6:10, it says, God is not unjust. He will not forget your work and the love you have shown Him as you have helped His people and you continue to help them. And then in Luke 6:38, what we said just now, but repeat it again. I mean, every time that you serve or every time that you feel any of these things are fading away, whether your happiness is fading, that you don't feel like being intentional, you don't feel like being, you're feeling a bit selfish in your serving, feeling a bit busybody, just remember these verses. God says, give and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over will be poured into your bosom. Our transactions are with the Lord. Not for pastor, not for the church. Our transactions that we do, us and God, settle the deal. That's it. Don't care about what other people do. Alright? So remember this. And remember to not judge, because before the blessing comes, don't judge. 1 Peter 4:10, it says, each one of us should use whatever gift he has received to serve others faithfully and ministering God's grace in its various forms. And Colossians 3 verse 23 to 24, work willingly at whatever you do. Do as though you were working for the Lord. We are working for the Lord rather than for people. Remember that the Lord will give you your inheritance as your reward, and that the master we serve is Christ. Amen. We're very blessed. We are here. We're in this place because of generations before us who have served in some way. People around, community who have served in some way. And we want to leave a legacy. We want to be this people, this church, where you don't have to have a ministry of serving, because you can just ask anybody and they would serve. Our time is not our own. Our time is God's. Our body is not our own. Our body is God's. Our money is not our own. Our money is God's. Our resources are not our own. It's God's. Our health is not our own. It's God's. So if we serve, we worship Him with everything that we have, we are basically investing, not selfishly, but into ourselves, because everything is between us and God, right? So just serve God. Amen. In Joshua 24, we know the famous verse. When Joshua asked the Israelites, who are you going to serve, right? And then they say, but if you refuse to serve the Lord, then choose today whom you will serve. And then he does the non-busybody thing. He said, but for me and my household, we will serve the Lord, right? I don't know whether he's talking about family or what. It does not matter. But I want this house to say, as for me and this house, we will serve the Lord. And it passes on, because the next generation sees us serving. There's so many generations, kids see their parents serving. It just becomes a thing. Like you know, oh, on Sundays I wake up at 7 a.m. It's just us. It just passes on. And so we want to make this choice. It's going to be a choice that we have to make every day, because our flesh is fighting, or the devil is fighting, the world is fighting, distractions are fighting. And it is a choice that we make daily, to serve Him with gladness, to serve Him intentionally, to serve Him selflessly, and to not be a busybody. But I want us to make this our prayer tonight. Come, let's this morning, come and stand up. That we choose today. If you're not going to serve, that's on you. But I want us to choose that this will be a declaration. As for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. I mean, let's just close our eyes. Hold your hands over your heart. I'm just going to pray. Father, we thank you, O God, that you have called us and you've created us, O God, to serve and to worship, O Lord. O God, you have created us, O God, to do all that we can, O Lord, for you and for your name, O Lord. Help us, O Lord, to understand, O God, that everything that we do is for you and should be for you alone, O God. So we want to make this declaration. We want you to move in our hearts, O God. We are here, Lord, for you, O God. God, that we are here our whole lives, O God. Our whole beings, O God. Everything that we have, O God, is for you, Lord. We pray that you move in us, O God. And that we will be able to stand firm daily and say, Lord, that as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. We just thank you and praise you. May we just want to worship.